last time here at the Gold Club World Championship, but of course gets the rematch of the HGC Grand Finals. It was a difficult match for Fnatic. They did get one game, the only game that KSB lost in all of BlizzCon, but even still, the dominance of KSB, I don't expect a change in this series.
I feel like Scoops in his interview with this year's kind of broken down best, right? Because a lot of the teams here have had roster swaps and have made a lot of changes. And the team that displayed dominance throughout all of BlizzCon is one of the few that have just had more time to grow as a roster and as a unit. And so everyone here is kind of thinking, like, is anyone even really, for me at least, going to be, can they take that game off of that game? And yes, I do think that is going to be possible and one of the best teams to be able to do so will be.
Yeah, I think that's one of the cool things about the format of this event, is because it is so long and everyone plays so many games. I think it's very unlikely that we see KSB actually go the same and not lose any games at all, just because you have so many best of twos, right? We know KSB, and they feel dominant. They do, sometimes, like, to display that with things like gold swaps or picking out of the box heroes like a first time did that versus deadly cannons.
Undefeated or only dropped one game, but they were far and above, even though they didn't win the entirety of the tournament, results-wise into the group stage, setting themselves apart from the rest of the tournament. But here they are in the roster, Taste, Reset, Rich, Kilcher, and Shaka. These guys are going to join the experience here in the analysis and experts of Taste and Reset. They will be done.
Team who is not planning on doing anything new here. The team is the exact opposite. Just like we talked about earlier today, this is a new iteration of the Titan that
such a very difficult role to be able to kind of learn how to be able to play at a world-class level. Even though it is in the melee area the same way the Warrior was, I just can't help but feel like it is going to be a very difficult challenge for Epic to understand his damage output capabilities and going to his survivability against a team as dominant as KSB. But I'm also, you know, excited to see what has he learned within the small time frame to be on that team.
Yeah, do they have to stay with the Warrior? Find out.
We'll be right back.
MSV Black, MVP Black, if you don't recognize his name. I'm so pumped for the series. It's been the most exciting series that we've been looking forward to all day long. For the first day of 7 days of best of twos as each team takes on each other in this group stage.
It's one of my favorite formats to be able to, you know, see them. Not only about games in playoff, but also the culture kind of developing between these teams. It becomes such a, you know, kind of intimate environment here at the hotel, hanging out, seeing all the practice rooms. Everybody's, you know, just scrimming it up, trying to enjoy Heroes of the Storm to become the best team that they can be. But here we are with the map of bands. ASP is going to actually rid of Sky Temple Dragon Shard Movement for Fnatic, returning to a classic game for them and taking us to what we would have expected, the only win they were able to get in the Grand Finals versus MVP Black on first time.
Sky Temple Bands, a bit of a strange one for KSV, but it's a respect win for Fnatic and how strong they have been on that, limiting the number of large battle maps that Fnatic can dominate with their incredible macro plays, forcing, or trying at least, to force Fnatic to come to them for the team fights, where we heard Rich talk about. They love the aggression. Immediate Dahaka ban from KSV. Still need to try to make sure that they are limiting some of the globals for Fnatic. But yeah, you mentioned it, KSV did lose on this map, but it's not like it was a standard strategy they lost with there. The old Triple Warrior Abathur.
The old Triple Warrior classic, you know? My dad's hotels of the old Triple Warrior compositions. It's been around a long while.
Now. Back in my day, we ran Quadruple Warrior with an Abathur. He was a solo support Abathur.
Pretty much that's how it went. We had to wait till the Hive Mind before we could team fight him. But that's been our ban response for Fnatic. Very generic here. We'll see what the first pick is going to be for KSV. If they want to go for something aggressive instead, just going to stick with the, you know, Gray Mane. It's not a surprise. I feel like Greymane and Rhaegar are the two, just generic, very good within the role, jack of all trades. They're going to be almost near, I would say, 100% involvement rate in a lot of these guys.
Yes, definitely. The involvement rate, very high. And even in the top half of the draft, I'd say you can see those. Unless you see some adaptations come in as a result of that. And that is the benefit of having such a long event. You could see certain meta things develop as a result of that, but as of now, Greymane picked, and then the Rhaegar ETC to counter. Fnatic getting ETC is pretty big here. KSV having to limit the globals of Fnatic does give them that ETC, and that was a big ban for KSV against Fnatic because of
this. This is actually really cool to see on a KSV, the fact that they're willing to commit to the KRZ in the position that they have, mainly because the Karzine is, like we were saying before, I was trying to say earlier in the past broadcast, is that the Reno Lucio is the one to use the force on Reno. You take one, I will always take the other. But to commit to the Karzine, which was a part of that high amount of other mobility, all of that, I thought with heavy impact being removed and not being the all in stun and only being slow, that that playstyle would die severely within this tournament. But already, KSV will really be able to against the team.
We can look at it in two different ways. KSV just sticking with the meta that they're playing before until they're forced to play something different, in a way of being able to keep some strategies, if they have any strategies, still at bay. But also, Fnatic loved Karzine on Crimson Hall specifically. They'd always pick it later on. Granted, that was always in a solo. That's how they beat KSV, and they already did get that earlier Rhaegar, but I don't think it's out of the realm of possibility that maybe Fnatic would feel more comfortable now with a double support style of composition. They were playing it more and more at BlizzCon already, and now, who knows, the world is their oyster now that they have this new roster.
The ball that can be made out there, really that surprised the fans, especially the ball that would be the Gray Mane. It's kind of interesting that it has become these kind of staples within the support assassins and the warrior roles right now, just between those two of each, and it's just really, how much of those can you get that synergize with the remainder of them, and can you make any kind of power play here? The no team really pulling it like too far. I do feel like this 3-4 slot here for Fnatic needs to have quite a bit of, they have a very strong generic composition right now, but KSV, I mean, they're KSV, right? You gotta be looking for some kind of play that would have Fnatic on this new roster.
You know, I am interested to see that Leaming Ban, because at first I was like, well, it makes a lot of sense, man. There's just so many ways of being able to computer resets between Karzine and Greymane. You've got good X computers to give for more resets, and you've got the double double support every single game except a couple at BlizzCon. So maybe this is some adjustments that we've made since teams have started scrimming here at GCWC. Next two picks for Fnatic are Arthas and Falstad. So Bad Bunny sticking to a warrior for his first game with Fnatic.
It's going to be nice to have him sitting on one of those more comfortable hero synergies pretty well with the composition. And then having the Falstad on the map like Cursed Hollow, it's no surprise that Fnatic goes to that. It is, it provides boss control and synergies, but with the playstyle overall, I mean, it really is the trademark of the climb of Fnatic when you look at them. When they were just, you know, middle of the pack hero to suddenly one of the best in the world. KSB, what is going to be here on the back end of this draft? Immediately, you see that Fnatic has been in pro secondary main phase, BlizzCon. That was almost always the direction they were willing to go if they were able to pick it up. But I do feel like, again, with the lead being better than we already saw, and just considering the composition of the game, they'll probably avoid that direction too.
Another double support composition for KSB, and another Junkrat Dreadnought. We've had a good amount of Junkrat this tournament so far.
Then a cool dig for Fnatic. Going back to, you know, more of the comfort heroes here for all these players. Really, almost every single one of them is sticking to their core, you know, what they kind of need for themselves on. So very interesting for the team of Fnatic. At the same time, you know, sticking to your roots might be the best way to try to take on a ton of black and gas and be able to test out the waters. Figure out how things are going.
Fnatic has a lot of different tools with this competition. They've got this very cool platform, right? They've got Razor's ATC, which, as I was alluding to before, was something that was heavily banned versus Fnatic. Not just by KSB, by a lot of teams who listed as the game, which trying to control what Razor is really good at. But having Falstad trying to dictate fights didn't in a bubble to give favor to either one of them because of the displacement of Junkrat with TLC?
Oh, that's a tough one. Again, that's a tough one mainly because they do have the Junkrat. It does feel like they have to, like, use a lot of tools. Yes, it is pretty well-rounded, but I do feel like it's a bit tamed as well.
say though, if we see Sake, I don't know who will be playing. I think Mikyocha actually can play differently, but should we see him dive in and try to get aggressive, if you have a Horrify to pick the Psy off, and trying to separate out the double support composition of KSV, Fnatic might just be able to get a kill right away. They have a lot of lockdown. There is no cleanse until 16 when you can get cleansing touch. So it does fall down to things like Palm, you having a sound barrier to saving capability. So maybe that's something that Fnatic can do. They're the ones who are trying to get the fight started. They're the ones trying to control it with either an aggressive gust or Horrify. For our final hype match of the evening. Dread, 7 days of group play. It's so exciting.
Yes, the thing that excites me the most is that I'm expensive too. I know that seems weird, but I actually really enjoy the BO2 system and just kind of how the map selection just goes, you know, you get one, I get one, and nobody feels like that game really like going out of the direction, and that it does go into the same process of like the seeding in the long run. Anytime we kind of get that right, Robin Jordan, I'm a huge fan of. Beyond just the, again, what I was talking about with the culture and all the other things that we get through this week here in Beijing.
Yeah, it's been very enjoyable experience to be here so far. I get to hang out with the teams. They've got these big areas, rooms to, like, practice in that we can go and chill out in. So that's been really fun to get to see them and get to hear them and talk to them about their new rosters. It kind of feels like this event is obviously very exciting, but I also love that we get this while the roster swaps were happening, so that it's almost like a nice sneak peek, a preview, if you will, as much as a practice session for a lot of these teams that did go through roster swaps.
Yeah, it is actually a really cool kind of just to be able to get that taste of what these teams might be capable of, you know? I feel like Round 20 is already on that same note, kind of giving me like, wow, you know, I'm pleasantly surprised with the performance that we're able to display here with the roster changes. And, you know, you wouldn't have had that, you know, without the GCWC to kind of display that, so that's really important.
Yeah, and it's not even just within your region that you're starting to get that practice or scrims themselves, but for one, it's international experience, international practice versus a team like Ballistics or KSV, right?
Yeah.
And then for two, it's tournament experience, which is just a whole different level than scrims.
And it's a, you know, man, that's, there's a whole, like, tournament strategy theory going through my head right now.
We must hear about
it. We're going down the rabbit hole.
We must hear this.
Okay, so you could argue that if you, as a five-man roster, if you weren't able to be synergistic and cohesive enough, that going to the international level fast enough would actually deter your rate of growth. Because you would not, that when a player is so much greater than you, you fail to be able to understand how to mimic, right? You embody them because you're trying to do what you know a player better than you is doing, rather than being able to fathom the jump, like the reasoning behind those things. And so it's kind of, you toe that line of assuming your skill level reached a certain threshold, or at least your understanding of your opponents will hit that threshold where you can grow at that rate. And then just, I don't know, it's like you could say that there is an equal trade off with that. If you aren't at that level, you just wasted your time and got topped at the ranks of the
past. I'm sure you could glean some sort of experience from that. We'll see. I guess we'll be able to ask teams at the end of it when all is said and done. I do believe the music means that we are about to get into a super exciting match. I cannot believe we get KSV versus Fnatic on the very first day. It's like somebody scheduled that or something.
It is almost like somebody, in fact, did schedule it. As you said, because of how this tournament goes, because we have group stage and we have the knockout stage, it is very, very so this one's pretty obvious, just because of this kind of great finals.
Yeah.
But if you had to pick any two other teams as your second best matchup, I would love to see this one. I
really want to see KSV versus Ballistics. I'm
previous meeting when maybe the other teams were unable to do so, but this is going to be them in the blue, your reigning world champions, KSV Black. Going to have Tiss on Murden, Reset playing the Gray Man, Rich on Junkrat, Kyoto playing Lucio, Karzeem played by Sake.
So
what
is Sake playing at Karzeem? While in the red, number one seed at the end of HGC Europe, we've got Fnatic Tactics playing Falstad Greedies on ETC, Mene playing Gul'dan, Smaxy on Rhaegar, and Bad Vinny playing Arthas. It's just gonna be some adjustment for me to see Mene on Fnatic. Fnatic Mene.
Yeah, it is a little weird to get used to. You know, I mean, even with Bad Vinny, it's still a little bit more, you know, kind of difficult to look at and be like, yeah, that adds up. But I feel like Vinny, again, with how long he was on the top roster, it's still a little bit harder to get used to. Much like, you know, I feel like for North America, when you see nine guys start going elsewhere, you're like, wait a minute, this doesn't have a brain. Winning situation here, though, for the team. No team trying to force that 1-1-3 advantageous trialing.
MVP Black, or KSV, that's going to happen a lot. My apologies, people, sending up a few to KSV just to respond to Fnatic. But Kyoto takes the damage, tries to speed out in time. Hit by the hammer in, but just fine back behind the gate.
That was, you know, the fact that Kyoto was able to make it out of his transition in that gate is actually really good, beyond just the experience out of avenue. It just shows the usage here of him onto Lucio. I think it was rather clever, even when you look at his ability to move up there and get the boop, and then when he was swapping over the mobility, it makes me pretty excited to see Kyoto onto this Lucio. Also, as you said, Sokka and Kyoto, or Karzeem, excuse me, is probably, in my opinion, it's my favorite Karzeem to watch in the world. Like, I'm very happy that he is on the Karzeem now. It's to the point where he, you know, like, even watching here in the tournament at GCWC, all the teams scrimming stuff when he's solo queue playing it, he's just absolutely monster.
I think what's really weird when you keep watching KSV is just how amazing Sake is as a support player. So much so that this team can entrust Sake to solo support when KSV drafts Tracers with Kyocha on it. It is insanity to me that we have seen Sake run so many roles in his time playing for MVP, now KSV, and be incredible no matter what he's on.
It's almost like, you know, he took the Galeforce Esports four flexible support and he's just like, you know what? I don't need four of them, I'm just gonna do it right. You know, I'm just gonna be the one man band who can do a little bit of everything here.
Have you seen a Sake tank?
We have never seen a Sake tank. I don't believe it. If we have, I think it was, again, kind of that rule swap, pretty confident against their opponents. First tribute here, going to spawn right up. Fnatic's got Quackings up on the top to deal with the Jinx. Maybe have a problem. Talking about a problem, though, Sake's going to have one here up a mini supply. Yes. The dash, though, is not available.
Have it.
And Smex is going to go ahead and clean that up there with a nice bite. But it comes at the cost of a tribute.
First blood claimed by Fnatic now is Tiss and Bad Vinny. Rich clearing that out. Senior Rich looking at the talent build for Junkrat. Seems to be what we were seeing from
Yeah.
But yeah, earlier today, where it's a lot of focus into your frag launcher. You build up with the taste of explosions, the damage every time you hit a hero at 4, and then later on. I think we actually had endless nades for the cooldown reduction, just to constantly have that poke, and maybe we'll see that here because you want to have a lot of poke, but since it's 16, you could also see the threat falling. You have so many grenades out on the field with that area of effect damage.
The biggest thing I'm looking for when it comes to the earlier stages of this game is if this group resource is going to be, how well is this burning raving process going to be effective, since, again, the nerf that comes into the heavy effect is a very big setback back to get that lockdown.
Giants, you're the first tribute, going to Bruisers, then second. side mirror.
But anyway, it's not the group that is going to have a really good job of trying to focus on making sure Lucio has, you know, you also need to get the sound barrier. It's not necessarily a hard counter, but as we always talk about the let's break it and then you never hear anything else, Horrify is really good at being able to deal with that, because when you hear that noise, you know they're going to clock, and all you have to do is find the Lucio, and you can probably find two others on top. So I'm going to be looking to just see, you know, how he's going to capitalize on it. Well, Dan, I don't want to use the word out of meta, but it's pretty close to that point, especially considering it's cursed. I know he has kind of had a recent slow and steady climb, but by no means would I consider this the top-tier mage, like a lot of the other heroes that we have in the meta.
Yeah, really just mages in general. Ever since mobility has become more and more favored by teams, the ability to dive with things like Genji being released, Greymane 2 being such a popular mage for so long. Li Ming still has mobility of her own, so she kind of trends to stay in, depending on the region, and especially we saw a lot of picks of her at HGC Finals, but yeah, overall, the cool Dan is an interesting one, but of course does play into Mene being able to play more of his comforts.
So we'll be able to see Tiss in that transition is going to be just fine. It's always dead even when it comes to experience. You see them mirroring each other when it comes to camps. It is just who is going to be able to pick up this next champion. Even if it does go over to KSB, it's not that problematic. It early curses not the end of the world if you have the global advantage over your opponent, as long as you do not let KSB's 5-man death fall or kill an aggressive trio by a couple of picks during that small window.
Starting to head up now that he's been able to clear some of the minions there. World of Blades for Venus Guard is with Tire Sensor, strikes with Divine Palm there. And Greymane is still considering everything we would normally expect from Fnatic as the Sunset is right, goes down. Gust hoping to save ETC, but it's not in time. He'll fall.
I asked the question, KSB, my goodness, they just moved in and immediately got the one shot there onto ETC of all heroes. Just going to go ahead and start the channel. Rest of KSB zoning out there. Sake putting the punches in the ground.
Oh!
This isn't done. Oh. He goes in, forces the Ancestral there on the bandit.
Yeah, he jumped in along with the Riptire too. Yeah, everybody's falling pretty low, but Tiss deep in the back line. Stagehand's going to come back in as ETC comes back, knocks Tiss out of the Dwarf Toss. He'll bring him down. Fnatic are coming back.
He said it's under a bit of pressure. Maybe out a bit too far as he's going to get booted. Punch is coming out from Sake, but please, he has the stun there. Salmary is going to go ahead and drop from Yosha. And this is just a forever fight here between the two teams. When, you know, the smoke clears, we're going to see the Fnatic and Fred's trade near dead even. And the fact that the Giants are pressuring throughout all of bottom, KSB got no siege damage done. This is a colossal win for Fnatic.
So, so big for Fnatic that they took that fight. They had the Giants at the bottom. They were not cleared by Ridge because they hit 10 and wanted to make sure they had everybody ready for the tribute to get it first. And that cost KSB. Now, they are trying to recover from that. They take down a fort in the top, so they'll lose the movement. But to look at the experience, to know that you have had three tributes now that you not paid dearly for, but you spent a lot of time acquiring, and that you are dead even, basically, in experience with the team, is not where KSB want to be right now.
And for a moment, we did see Greymane hold on to the road to a soccer, and we're actually considering difference for what happened in the start for a moment. But he did end up going towards that first bullet and the 7-7. So all of this is just about, can we blow up the Arthur small flag? He's going to blank. He gets Gus in the, or barrel in the Gus. Horrified immediately drop there on the jump grab. But Rich is going to keep himself alive with that concussion. Fine. And actually, this is KSB turning around. This is fine.
Here comes the Riptire, and Ancestral Healing has to be used early on just because of how much damage that thing does in the center of it. No additional kills for KSB. That mine was just like best case scenario for Ridge. Like literally that Horrify was super good. Everything was just amazing. The gust into the Horrify was like, there is no way that KSB does not start losing people here. At least Ridge, that mine was so good.
Yeah, that was absolutely insane. I mean, Junkrat's a pretty squishy guy, you know?
Yeah.
It's not like that HP pool sits very, very high, and the fact that he was able to get that kind of self-heal on himself, and then the rest of KSB was willing to take that kind of sacrifice and get themselves a kill on top of it here. Very impressive skirmishing still here for KSB, but it's not like Fnatic isn't displaying prominent team fight as well, as we talked about that skirmish up on top, and stalling that out in the middle of the day. It is really why I would say Fnatic has an advantage over Junkrat.
So that line that we just saw gets even better now for Junkrat because he has the additional range. And if it only hits him, it greatly reduces the cooldown too, so you even used it to quickly rotate up now so that he could defend the boss from Fnatic. Kind of trade on bosses between both the teams. But now, after being able to win that last team fight with the one kill that they acquired from that hit, they're starting to pull ahead further in experience.
Tribute's going to go ahead and spawn in advantageous condition for KZ. But it's also got the boss up on top of it. Sunset Striker down on Bad Pick with the Crystal Bullet. Stage Dive is used for more. Suck is in a bad spot. He's going to have to lay some kind of total. But it's back there. No follow up CC there. They're going to just go ahead and stall this out. The Tribute not going to be started the team quite yet.
Really love the adaptations from both sides. Like, Freeze taking Stage Dive to be able to give them an additional global, and there's a lot of different ways of stopping a mosh pit. But then KSB to make sure that they have the speed boost so that when the stage dive went down, everyone was able to clear out pretty much. And then fast rotations. KSB always has this great sense of smell. They know when a rotation's going to come in and start trying to attack them. Obviously, there it was because there was a tribute there too, but even just in lane, they have a really solid idea of when someone's going to come in and gank somebody. So they are always there to show up and make sure they can save the team.
That's all I heard.
Yeah, I mean, you can just. Clearly, KSB can smell them all away.
I mean, they smell good though.
Yes.
Have you walked by?
Have you seen all of that hair product?
Yeah,
no way.
It just smells like it's like the greatest hair salon I've ever walked into. Next Tribute is going to go ahead and spawn here. Very good positioning already. The fact that Fnatic is collapsing around this is a huge win for them. Tiss is going to go ahead and spawn. Delicious. Sorbo not able to land. Riptide's going to go right through. Seven side and dropped. Pushback there from Breeze is able to make sure that Bad Bang's the only one to receive the damage.
Good setup for Fnatic that they only used Gust and all of that because you look at the other side, there's a lot of heroic abilities used from KSB. Do they stay? It would not mean if Fnatic got a curse, but they do have that great move. So Gust's a little strong without losing anybody. They could potentially get to 16. Mid, not really a solid place for them to be able to slow down. Maybe get up to the top. Rich, he's back. It's fine. He has that cooldown reduction. He's good.
Yeah, no, that was totally fine. Freeze under a lot of pressure. He's an ancestral. Tiss goes in there to score.
And this goes with the Junkrat damage as well as the damage from Cocktail. Horrify, though. This should be the end of Tiss. Sound barrier keeping him alive for now, but no avatar. And just before 16, KSB lose their Marina.
They don't have the 16 talents here, but it is still kind of closing rather quick. Reset. Caught up with your 15 bar. Suck is going to go ahead and give you some of that mobility thanks to that level 13 talent. If they have to find themselves, you know, kind of reeling back into this game and the experience after that skirmish and have gone against them, and now more importantly, they're rounding that first point. I'm expecting that they will make their curse a lot more powerful than that we saw at KSB, considering not only is the later stages where the curse is going to be a bigger problem, it's not a longer duration, but the minions do more damage. But they have the global advantage, and it makes the curse really just very easy to get in powerful objective.
Yeah, because of that, KSB needs to be ready to brawl when the next tribute phase starts. They have mercenaries in the top, the Kurokis here in the mid. If they're under the double stand, I'm sure that would take some time for Fnatic to deal with. Because they cleared that out before going to get their own, maybe they better push them now, but they are going to head straight to the tribute spot since they have the better setup here.
This is a huge win for KSB in terms of spawns. Just because that chokehold is so very open and it's left or right, so it's very easy for KSB to win. Kind of back and forth as long as no collapse happens from the struggle up and above. Those both teams are going to be very hyper focused on making sure that is not. I assume that KSB's team fight at least will look a bit cleaner than it did in the other parts, whereas it was more just the watch as much on somebody and then can't connect to this friend.
Tiss is really trying to make sure that Chad Bitty doesn't come around from the side for a play. Steps forward, giving space to reset. Dive right back out. Really don't want to clump too much here. The Cloud 5, potential fly gust from the Cloud Banks, or gust in both.
It should be noted that they have giants pushing up on top.
Yep.
All of those, so that is really it. It's Fnatic's time. It's going to be so Chase is not even starting in the back quite yet. He really wants to get that support. He's going to find himself somewhere, and it's a very good pick down from the wall. No follow up from Reese quite yet. Let's go down
here. Man. It's a lot of parole abilities. Save keeping that many alive, but it works. They take out Grammy and Riptar. Goes in. Fnatic gets a curse.
And they get the curse. It's not actually works. It's Dash just trying to make sure that he's going to get that stall out. Or by Newstis able to door toss over the wall, but I don't think he's much longer for this world. Giants up on top are something that somebody on the side of Fnatic is going to have to answer to unless they're looking for a bigger play. Maybe keep slash bust the game. It's going to be easy. Go ahead and start the skirmish. He'll be ready to join.
Twisty tried to get everything they can out of this first. Tried to get the big spike off of really all the forces that were still up. PSV had everything stuck up. Fnatic, but we're looking at the boss first, which tells us then they are going to, looks like now, move up and try to make the double boss play. They've got the minions now pushing in every single lane and knowing that KSP has to deal with that kind of boss, they just head back on up, keeping Clark next to him, so.
I want to see what Fnatic wants to do with the second boss up on top. It's pretty expected that it's going to be there on the top, we're just going down. It's 16 minutes in, and that typically is reliable for at least, you know, three quarters of the game, to, depending on how much potency you have, you could say that it will be tighter, but they do have Gust to be able to zone off if necessary, and to horrify. It's just, which of the two options are they going to choose? Are they going to rely on the Gul'dan poke and Kraken? It looks like they very much want to keep it tighter, but they're cracking the wave as well to make sure that they get in as far as possible, get all set with them. But essentially, do they want more siege and focus on the heroes to make sure they get that? Which I think they're going to want to, or do they focus more on the team by getting a couple of kills and get a lot of kills and you have no way of stopping this?
Yeah, it's, they definitely made that conscious decision not to try to sweep out, just push maybe and like posture down around the bottom feet while the minions push the rest and try to give them one play. But they still got this boss to push back. The tower's fully healthy. How much they can get done with it.
Wall is pretty easy work. Still above 75% HP. There, the fact that they stop below 50%, there's no way that he's going to be able to stop this unless they easily get the situation. Disco comes up with some of those. Ancestral Healing does end up landing, though. Smacks with the reaction, and now the members of Fnatic with comfortable Riptar goes in, does a bit of damage, and now Dance Keep wants to try and play this fight for the realm, but I don't know if Fnatic's going to get it.
Knock on back, Benny immediately turns tail, runs straight into the base of KSV, not allowing them to chase him down, get the kill, and then get kills on anybody else in the team. So Fnatic walk away with the keep, they lose one, but they do open up a way for them to win the game. They win the team fight decisively.
The biggest thing here has got to be because we just saw the curse happen. And the fact that it's been a double plus by all people, a lot of this tribute is going to spawn before Arthas can actually, you know, meet anywhere up the, on the map. And now Dance is going to be in a position where they are at the point. And that is never somewhere you want to be in this position. This person is suddenly a win condition available. Both the bosses are not going to be available for a long time. So, Fnatic, even though they have a lot of bosses in control and the composition, they are winning this game due to that top keep. They're going to hit a kind of very awkward timing window that they maybe could have avoided if that thing had been able to stop the boss or
something. And that was a good Riptire, too.
Yeah, it was.
To start from that, to pull him back, he used Army from that, but the healing just wasn't going to be enough once all of KSV started to follow suit and jump on top of them. But the immediate recognition from that mini, he is, he's, even though he's switched over to the melee flex, we're still playing the sacrificing person. You know, you can see the old habits from him doing well there. EGC is still holding on to this level 20, but we have the wind tunnel that Fnatic is known for.
Unless you have sanctification or void, there's no opportunity to they stop. Paul says, go ahead and fly. He said, what's it down? He says, it's going to storm you. Good amount of poetry.
Such a good talent to be filled that probably is going to Kisake without having so many more charges of losing death. So we have 100 fists with it. Damage here.
Oh, combo. Cecil goes down, but it's actually a misclick there. The power slide, body block over the bend. To win the spider.
Arthas is still fully healthy again. He had Army of the Dead. He has anti-magic shell to try to help with some of this damage from KSV.
Look at Mene.
Mene is so low.
That's one heal, and that's a solo support. That's as much as you're getting for a long while. But that's going to be enough to zone them off and get a KSV in this curse. But they're not afraid of a fight. You see the sharpening onto the side there.
Yeah, that's where the lowest health boost is for them, being able to take out that keep would let KSV even out the...
No way. They're going to try. Okay. No, I thought for a moment they were like, this is like the cool way using the wind tunnel. It's like, you know, I've seen wilder strategies here, but it looks like the members of Fnatic will end up backing. The damage on TV, but you see KSV, they're concerned about their core as well. Just because of Fnatic and not shooting for so long, it's like, yeah, they could try to get that backdoor play.
Scary moment for KSV. They have their team down. They do have the team in down now. Flying Gust and Wind Tunnel Horrify immediately after. And Fnatic takes out Junkrat so fast. Sound Barrier now trying to keep the rest of the team, the rest of KSV alive. And they do bring down ETC, but the Deathmatch catches three of the remaining members. Lucio falls. Fnatic are bringing down KSV one by one.
The two members of KSV immediately go back to the situation because they realize that that's not going to be my fight. And it's enough to, I was going to say, it's enough to at least make sure that Fnatic cannot move across the map to secure the game, but the fact that that's a double boss playoff in a 30-second window where they are not going to have Rich or the Lucio or Draymond to be able to join this fight, I don't think Tiz can zone off this one on his own. It was 17 seconds away from the Gust, even then, no problem.
Great to be able to take out Fnatic ideally, but Ancestral Healing is available for Fnatic here. KSV know the situation, they know the problem, they don't have a keep in this lane. They'll do everything they can to try to scare Fnatic off, but now it comes down to a fight on the other side of the boss, maybe?
Seven-sided strike just came up. Yes, they have to move past the boss and they can't let it get to core. They need to wait until somebody overextends it. I think they're going to use this Riptire or at least something with Junkrat. There's a stage dive.
Oh, that stops it. Tiz goes down. So does Saki. He will after the seven-sided strike. Fnatic take down two, and this looks to be...
Damn.
Yep.
About no way of battle. You just can't see the world where KSV is going to be able to get the defense here. Knowing that there is still a win to be horrifying, even in a dream scenario where you get a pick onto one of those core damage units and the bosses, and there is so much credit control to be able to do. Fnatic looks to move on to the core, and this is going to be the very first game reenacting a bit of the BlizzCon Grand Finals. First map going over to Fnatic.
And they're getting a little feisty about it, I'd say.
Rightly so.
Yeah.